probability and counting. We're going to discuss the fundamental principle of counting, combinations, permutations, the permutation rule, and how this all fits with probability. Consider the following scenario. If you have two different shirts and three different pairs of pants, how many outfits do you have?
Shirt 1, pant 1 is an outfit. Shirt 1, pant 2 is a second outfit. Shirt 1, pant 3 is a third outfit. Shirt 2, pant 1 is a fourth outfit. Shirt 2, pant 2 is a fifth outfit. And shirt 2, pant 3 is the last outfit. If we notice, there are a total of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 outfits associated with 2 shirts and 3 pairs of pants. 6 outfits is the answer.
The fundamental principle of counting. If task 1 is accomplished in n distinct ways, and task 2 is accomplished in m distinct ways, then the tasks together are accomplished in n times m distinct ways. This is also known as the multiplication rule for counting, because what we end up doing is multiplying together the number of ways to perform each of the different tasks together.
If we go back to the outfit problem, this time using the fundamental principle of counting, also known as the multiplication rule, we'll notice that there are 2 options for our first task. That means there were 2 shirts to choose from. Now, the second task is picking the pair of pants. For the pair of pants, there are 3 different pairs to choose from. So the multiplication rule, or the fundamental principle of counting, says take the number of ways to perform the first task, which is 2, combined with the number of ways to perform the second task, which is 3, and multiply these numbers together. Notice, when you multiply 2 with 3, the answer is 6. That means there are 6 different outfits that can be made when you have 2 shirts and 3 pants. This is what the fundamental principle of counting says that we can do to deduce the answer.
How many gender sequences are possible when having 2 children?
Once again, if we start with a tree diagram, the first pair of branches correspond to having our first child. The different sexes that we can have when we have our first child is a boy or a girl. Now for the second child, we'll have 2 branches again, because for the second child, it could be either a boy or a girl. So now when I follow my branches, I'll have BB, which means 2 boys, BG, a boy and a girl, GB, a girl then a boy, and GG, 2 girls. So that when I count, I will discover there are 1, 2, 3, 4 different gender sequences that are possible when you have 2 children. Now, By the fundamental principle of counting, or the multiplication rule, I can answer the same question. But this time I think of it this way. There are two different tasks here. The first task is having the first child. The second task is having the second child. Now, there are two different sexes associated with that first child. And there are two different sexes associated with having the second child. So when I multiply these tasks together, I will discover that the answer is indeed 4. Meaning, there are 4 different gender sequences that are possible when you have 2 children.
How many outcomes are possible when you roll 2 dies, also known as dice?
When you roll 2 dies together, if we look at the multiplication rule, or the counting principle, we still have 2 tasks here. The first task is rolling the first die, in which there are 6 possible outcomes when you roll a die. When I roll the second die, perform the second task, there are another 6 outcomes associated with the second task. So that when I multiply these two numbers together, 6 times 6, the answer is 36. So, by the multiplication principle, or the fundamental principle of counting, we will discover that there are 36 different possible outcomes associated with rolling 2 dies.
How many outcomes are possible when you pick 2 cards with replacement? With replacement really means that we allow repetition. Once you select an item, it gets placed back in the pool, ready to be selected possibly again. Compare that to without replacement, which means we do not allow repetition. Once an item is selected, it is kept out of the pool of items.
Drawing 2 cards from a standard deck with replacement. Once again, there's 2 tasks here. The first task is drawing that first card. The second task is drawing the second card. Now, since there are 52 cards in a deck, there are 52 different cards that can be chosen for that first card, or the first task. Since this is with replacement, we're putting the card back. They are, again, another 52 different cards that can be chosen for the second task. So by the multiplication principle, if we multiply 52 times 52, also known as 52 to the second power, we will deduce the answer. There's 2,704 different possible outcomes when we pick 2 cards from a deck with replacement.
How many outcomes are possible when you pick two cards now without replacement?
Consider selecting two cards again from a standard deck, this time without replacement. For the first task, there are 52 cards in the deck. Once we choose a card, since this is without replacement, we throw it out the window. We keep it from the deck, so that when we go back and choose the second card, or determine the number of outcomes for the second task, we will now find that there are 51. There are 51 cards in the deck that are remaining. So when I multiply 52 times 51, I will determine the total number of outcomes associated with selecting two cards from a standard deck without replacement. We discover that there's 2,652 possible outcomes.
The fundamental principle of counting can be generalized. Consider the outfit problem again. This time you have an outfit that consists of pants, shirts, belts, and ties. In this example, you have 12 pairs of pants, 8 distinct shirts, 4 different belts, and 6 ties. How many different outfits are possible now?
This time, we have 4 tasks here. As we have seen, the counting principle can be generalized, meaning we have a first task, a second task, a third task, and now a fourth task. If the first task is associated with picking our pants, in which we know that there are 12 pairs, the second task is associated with picking our shirts, in which we know we have 8. The third task is associated with picking our belts, in which we have 4 belts. The last task, the fourth task, is associated with picking our ties, in which we know we have 6. The counting principle, or the fundamental principle of counting, also known as the multiplication rule, which is generalized here, we can determine the answer by simply multiplying the number of ways to perform each one of these individual subtasks. 12 times 8 times 4 times 6. There are 2,304 different outfits that are possible.
How many gender sequences are possible when having 3 children? Note, repetition of gender is allowed.
When having 3 children and determining the number of gender sequences that are possible, we have 3 subtasks here. The first, the second, and the third. Now, each one of these subtasks corresponds to having a child. In other words, for the first child, you have two sexes for the first child. It could be either a boy or a girl. For the second task, or the second child, you also have two sexes associated with having the second child. And finally, on the third child, you have two sexes associated with having the third child. So that each task, you have two ways or two distinct options for each task. The fundamental principle of counting, also known as the multiplication rule, requires us to multiply these values together. So we have 2 times 2 times 2, also known as 2 to the third power, which is the value 8. In other words, there are 8 gender sequences possible when you have 3 children. Now, recall, a tree diagram would look something like this. We'll start here. The first child, we can have a boy or a girl. For the second child, we have either a boy or a girl again. For the third child, a boy or a girl. And what we're going to ultimately end up doing is following the branches. B, B, B. B, B, G. B, G, B. B, G, G. G, B, B. G, B, G. G, G, B. And G, G, G. If we count these outcomes, we'll discover there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. There are 8 different gender sequences that are possible when having 3 children.
How many phone numbers are possible in the 323 area code? Note, the repetition of single digits is allowed.
Having phone numbers, or determining the total number of possible phone numbers in any area code, in particular the 323, looks like the following. We have the first task, which corresponds to selecting the first digit. The second task, which corresponds to selecting the second digit. The third task, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, and the seventh task. So that for this problem of phone numbers, there are 7 subtasks here. Now, each subtask corresponds to selecting a single digit. A single digit is a number that's either 0, 1, 2, 3, all the way up to the number 9. And so remember, with phone numbers, we do allow repetition because there are phone numbers that have the same digit in the sequence. So repetition here is allowed. Now notice, if we're going to check, or we're going to determine the number of outcomes for that first task, we have to know how many single digits can be the first number. If we count the numbers 1 through 9, that's 9 outcomes. And when we include the 0, that's 10. So, for the first digit, you have 10 different possible outcomes. For the second digit, since we allow repetition, you have the same 10 single digits. And so on, until ultimately what you have by the counting principle is the task of multiplying the number 10 repeatedly 7 times, which is also known as an exponential. It is 10 to the 7th power. Now 10 to the 7th power is a 1 followed by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 zeros, which means there are 10 million different phone numbers possible in the 323 area code, or really in any particular area code. This is how you'd answer the question, but please note that the single digits here are the numbers 0 through 9, in which there are 10 of them, and we allow repetition.
A byte is a sequence of 8 bits. A bit is a value that is either a 0 or a 1. And every character has a unique byte sequence. A character is a number, a letter, either lower or uppercase, or any other symbol found on a keyboard. 01101101 may represent a lowercase letter a, while 10010110 may represent the uppercase letter a. 00100100 may represent the number 4. 11101100 may represent the exclamation mark. These are all examples of bytes. Repetition of single digits is allowed. Determine the number of possible bytes that represent characters.
Now remember, a byte is a sequence of 8 bits. In other words, it's a sequence of 8 0 or 1s, since a bit is a value that's either 0 or 1. So what we have here really is 8 subtasks, or 8 tasks that we have to perform. For the first task, there are two options, a 0 or a 1. Remember, that's called a bit. For the second task, or the second bit, you have the same two options, either a 0 or a 1. Notice here, repetition is allowed. So for the third, you have another two, the 0 or the 1. The fourth, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh, and finally the eighth, we have two options, a 0 or a 1. So, by the fundamental principle of counting, or the multiplication rule, the total number of bytes is 2 to the 8th power. Now, using our calculator, we can compute 2 to the 8th power using this caret key as a power key. What we have here is 2 to the 8th. Now, if I hit equals or enter, I'll discover that there's 256 different bytes that are possible. A byte, B-Y-T-E-S, is a sequence of 8 bits, and there are 256 bytes.
When you're sampling without replacement and repetition is not allowed, the definition of a combination is an unordered arrangement. It's an arrangement in which we do not care about the order. When sampling without replacement and repetition is not allowed, we have the definition of the word permutation. A permutation is an ordered arrangement. We do care about the order. Delivery routes. A delivery route is a stop at each of the following locations: Alhambra, El Monte, Monterey Park, Commerce, Burbank, Eagle Rock, and Montebello. This first arrangement of routes, Alhambra, El Monte, Monterey Park, Commerce, Burbank, Eagle Rock, and Montebello, is different from the second arrangement. Although they consist of the same exact cities, the same exact stops, they happen in different order. For in the case of delivery routes, we care about the order. This third arrangement is different from the first two. We care about the order in which we make our stops. So that means we have three distinct routes. These three different delivery routes are examples of permutations. A deluxe pizza is a pizza with five different toppings from the following pool of toppings: pepperoni, sausage, jalapenos, bell pepper, anchovies, onions, mushrooms, olives, and tomatoes. If we were to order a pepperoni, bell pepper, mushroom, olive, and tomato pizza, informing the person who sells the pizzas that we wanted a bell pepper, mushroom, olive, pepperoni, and tomato pizza is describing the same pizza. In fact, if we told the person we wanted a tomato, pepperoni, olive, mushroom, and bell pepper pizza, that is still yet the same pizza. That is, we do not care about the order of the toppings. These arrangements are combinations. We do not care about the order. The S Festival. Time allows for four acts to perform from the following list of acts: Van Halen, Kid Rock, Luis Miguel, Boyz II Men, Backstreet Boys, Hannah Montana, Motley Crue, The Ramones, Bee Gees, and Nelly Furtado. In selecting four acts, such as Van Halen, Hannah Montana, the Bee Gees, and Nelly Furtado, the question is this arrangement different than this next arrangement that consists of Hannah Montana, Bee Gees, Nelly Furtado, and Van Halen? And yet, is it different than this third list, Bee Gees, Van Halen, Nelly Furtado, and Hannah Montana? Because we care about the order of performers. That is, the headliner plays last and is the most important act, while the least important plays first, and so on. We are looking at three different arrangements because we care about the order of the acts. These three different rosters of acts are permutations. prizes. A contest is looking to raffle $300 prizes among the following contestants: John, April, Mary, Linda, Juan, Miguel, Liz, Tyler, and Robert. If the three winners turned out to be John, Mary, and Robert, and we mistakenly wrote down Mary, John, then Robert, or we wrote down Robert, Mary, and John, the question is, does it matter? We should really be asking, do we care about the order or do we not care about the order? And the answer is simple. Because the prizes are each of same value, $100, we do not care about the order of the names. These three different rosters of winners are combinations, because combinations are unordered arrangements. Compare that to the following raffle, where a contest is looking to raffle three prizes, where the first is $100, the second is $50, and the third is $25, amongst the same pool of contestants. If we were to discover John, Mary, and Robert was a winner, or Robert, Mary, and John was a winner, or we mistakenly wrote down Mary, Robert, or John as winners, are these combinations or permutations? Do we care about the order of the names of the winners? And the answer is yes, we do care about the order, because in this case, first prize is a different value than second and third prize. In fact, they're all of different values. So if you mistakenly place different names, then you have different types of winners. These three different rosters of winners are called permutations because we care about the order of the names. Order is important. NPR. The number of permutations of R items taken from a pool of N items. The formula is N factorial divided by the difference between N and R factorial. NCR, the number of combinations of R items taken from a pool of N items. It has a formula, N factorial divided by R factorial times the difference between N and R factorial. N factorial is defined to be the product of numbers. That is, you take the value n and you start to count backwards. From n, counting backwards, the next digit, the next value is n minus 1. And then the next value from that is n minus 2, and so on, all the way down to 2 times 1. And if you take all those values and you multiply them together, you're computing the value of n factorial. And as a fact, as an aside, 0 factorial is the value 1, and 1 factorial is also the value of 1. These values are going to be important in our computation. The deluxe pizza example. A deluxe pizza is a pizza with 5 different toppings from the following pool. How many different deluxe pizzas are possible?
For the deluxe pizza. Since order is not important and there are 9 toppings in our pool, these arrangements are combinations. A deluxe pizza requires that we select 5 toppings from the 9 when we don't care about the order. We could actually determine the value a few ways. We could use the definition of the number of arrangements or the number of combinations when you have a pool of 9 and you're selecting 5. That is the following. 9 factorial divided by 5 factorial times the difference of 9 minus 5 factorial. What we get is 9 factorial divided by 5 factorial times 4 factorial, because 9 minus 5 is 4. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. That's 9 factorial in the numerator. 5 factorial is 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. And 4 factorial is 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. Simplifying this fraction, or use the cancellation property, we'll discover that the 4 times the 3 times the 2 times the 1 cancels out. You can cancel the 5. 3 times 2 is 6, so I can cancel a 6. And 4 goes into 8 twice. So that the numbers that are left are the 9, 2, and the 7. Nine times 2 times 7 is the same as 18 times 7. If we perform this arithmetic of 18 times 7, 6, carry the 5, 7, we find that there are 126 different deluxe pizzas that are possible. There are 126 combinations. Arrangements when we do not care about the order. Since it's a pizza, the order is not important. Therefore, these are combinations. This is the long way. What I could have done is I could have chosen to use, again, our calculator and enter the 9 for the number of toppings. Go to the math mode and select probability. From probability, we go down to combinations. The function I'm going to use is the combination. I just now need to enter the number of toppings, which is 5. Now this is 9C5 as entered in my TI-83 calculator. If I hit enter, notice here the answer is 126. It's the same answer that I got when performing this computation by hand.
Delivery routes. A route consists of a stop at the following locations: Alhambra, El Monte, Monterey Park, Commerce, Burbank, Eagle Rock, and Montebello. Notice that the repetition of stops at a particular location is not allowed. That means once you visit a city, make a stop, you do not go back to that same city again. Repetition is not allowed. How many routes are possible?
A delivery route is a stop at each of the 7 locations, each of the 7 cities. So, we're going to have all the different routes and determine the total number of routes that are possible if we stop at each location. So, if we look at this from the counting principle, we're going to have 7 subtasks or tasks to perform. The first task is associated with the first stop. And if you look at this problem, there are 7 different options or 7 different locations that one can stop for the first stop. Once you visited the location, you do not come back to that same location. You have to go to the remaining locations. So for the second stop or the second task, there are now 6 different locations to visit. Once you've visited a stop, you cannot return to that same exact stop, that location. So for the third stop, or the third task, there are 5 different locations, and so on. 4, 3, 2, and 1. The counting principle says that we are to multiply these numbers together. 7 times 6 times 5 times 3 times 2 times 1. Now I'm going to use a shortcut called 7 factorial, because 7 factorial is defined to be 7 times 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. So in my calculator, what I can do, is multiply 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1, and determine that the answer is 5040. Now, this is the long way. We're multiplying all these numbers together, 7 and counting backwards, times 6, times 5, times 4, times 3, times 2, times 1, to obtain the value 5040. Again, this is the definition of 7 factorial. It's when you start with the number, count backwards all the way to 1, and you multiply all the numbers together. That's the definition of factorial. Our calculator does this for us. If we look at the math mode, we search for probability, will find the factorial key. So, if I enter 7, math, probability, go down to factorial, and hit enter. And hit enter again, notice I get the same value. There are 5040 different routes when you stop at each city or each location when there are 7 locations.
The S Festival. How many rosters of 4 are possible if time allows for 4 acts to perform from the following pool of acts?
The US Festival. Since we care about the order, these are permutations. Since there are 10 acts in the pool to choose from, in which we need only 4, since time allows for 4, if we determine 10P4, we will have our answer. Now, 10P4 by definition is 10 factorial divided by 10 minus 4 factorial, which really means we have 10 factorial over 4. 6 factorial. If we look at this the long way, and write down 10 factorial, and then write down 6 factorial in the denominator, and use the cancellation property, we will see that the 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1 cancels. What we are left with is the 10, 9, 8, and 7 in which we have to multiply. So 10 times 9 times 8 times 7 will give us our answer. Using the TI calculator, we will find that there is 5,040 different permutations. The answer is 5,040 different rosters of 4. We have a pool of 10 rock bands to select from. If we decide to use the TI calculator here, if we use the permutation key, we're going to enter the 10. We're going to look for the math mode. Probability. Now, instead of combinations, you select permutation. Hit enter. The calculator knows you're talking about a permutation. You just need to know the number of axed here that you're going to use, and that's 4. Hit enter, and you get 5,040. So this is the shortcut that can be used without having to go through all the arithmetic or the definition of factorial. The answer is the same, 5,040.
Prizes. A contest is looking to raffle $300 prizes among the following contestants. How many winning rosters are possible?
Now, when you have 3 prizes of $100, notice that the prize is the same, so that the order of the names is not important. We're talking about a combination here. Since there are 9 people in the pool and we need to select 3 of those people where the order is not important, the answer is 9C3. I can use the definition of combination to deduce the answer, or I can go straight to the TI calculator, enter the 9, look for the math mode, probability, combination, hit enter, and now I need the 3. So this is 9C3. The final answer is 84. There are 84 rosters of winners when we do not care about the order.
A contest is looking to raffle 3 prizes. First is 100, second is 50, and third is 25. How many winning rosters are possible?
Here we have 3 prizes. And the prizes here are not all the same. They are different, which means when you arrange the names, you do care about the order. Okay? So, if you care about the order, we're talking about permutations. There are a pool of 9 individuals in which we need to select 3 winners. So the answer will be 9P3. From our calculator, 9, math mode, probability, permutations, enter, 3. This is 9P3. 504. There's 504 different rosters of winners when we care about the order.
Delivery routes. A delivery route is a stop at each of the following locations. How many delivery routes are there?
For the delivery routes, 7 locations in which we need to stop at each one, and we care about the order of the stop, we're talking about permutations. There are 7 locations in our pool in which we have to stop at all 7 locations. So this answer is 7P7. If we go to our calculator and determine 7 math probability, permutation, 7, we'll discover that there is 5,040 distinct routes. That is the same answer that we got using the counting principle.
The 665 lottery. In order to win the 665 lottery, one has to obtain a sequence of 6 numbers from a pool of 65 numbers. How many sequences of 6 numbers are there?
A 665 lottery. For this arrangement of numbers, we do not care about the order in which we have these numbers or determine the numbers. And because we don't care about the order, this is a combination. There are 65 numbers in the pool in which we need 6 numbers to win this lottery. So that 65C6 will determine the total number of different possible sequences of 6. Again, the key here is that we don't care about the order of the numbers when we win, so long as we have the numbers. The order is not important. When the ball comes down to determine the winning sequence, it doesn't have to be in order, so long as we have those numbers. So the answer is 65C6. This is the total number of sequences of 6. Using our calculator, 65, math, probability, combinations, 6, enter. We get this large value. We're going to write this down and determine what it is. 8,258,880. This is 82,598,880. There are 82,598,880 different sequences of 6 numbers when taken from a pool of 65 numbers. Note again, we do not care about the order of numbers.
The permutation rule. Determining the number of arrangements of L distinct types of objects. Is n subscript k factorial divided by n1 factorial times n2 factorial all the way up to the product of nL factorial. Now remember, n is the number of objects and L is the different types of objects. And nk is if I take the sum of the different types of objects and add them together. For example, the word Mississippi. How many different words can be created by rearranging the letters in the word Mississippi?
If we're going to determine the number of words that are created and simply rearranging the letters from the word Mississippi, we have to look at the different types of letters and how many of each there are in the word. So I'm going to create a small frequency table here to keep track of the different types of letters and how many of each there are. We have the letter M, in which case there's one M. We have the letter I, and there are four I's. We have the letter S, there are four S's. The letter P, and there are two P's. There are a total of 11 distinct letters. So, the permutation rule has 11 factorial over 1 factorial times 4 factorial times 4 factorial times 2 factorial. Now, 2 factorial here is the number 2. 1 factorial is the number 1. So if I try to simplify what I have here a little, I have 11 factorial over 4 factorial times 4 factorial times the number 2. 1 factorial, which was here, well, we already know that 1 factorial is 1. So this can make my computation a little simpler. If I go to my calculator and try to enter this information, I would have to do it in the following way. 11, now look for the factorial key. Remember, it's under probability. Enter. Divided by. Now, I'm going to divide by everything that's down here. I'm going to divide by the 4 factorial times 4 factorial times 2. So, I'm going to need to use the parentheses after the division sign. Because in the parentheses, I'm going to have to enter all of this information. So, I have 4. And I'm going to look again for the factorial. Times another 4 factorial times the 2 factorial, or just the 2, I'm sorry. Close my parentheses and now hit enter. There are 34,650 different words in rearranging the letters from the word Mississippi. This is my final answer.
How many different words can be created by rearranging the letters in the word, word?
If I'm looking to rearrange the letters in the word word, again I use the permutation rule. And I go through the same procedure, which is to look at the distribution of letters in the word word. The W, the O, the R, and the D are all the letters in the word word. And there is one W, one O, one R, and one D for a total of four letters. Now from the permutation rule, this is 4 factorial divided by 1 factorial times 1 factorial times 1 factorial times 1 factorial. Now once again, 1 factorial is the value 1. So in the denominator, I have 4 ones to multiply together, which is the number 1. So that the final answer really is 4 factorial. So from my calculator, I'll look for the 4. And now I need my factorial key again. Hit enter. The final answer is 24. There are 24 different words that can be created when I rearrange the letters in the word, word. Note that each letter is different. There's one W, one O, one R, and one D. This is different from the prior example of Mississippi.
Gender sequences. How many gender sequences can be created by rearranging the letters in the word BBGGBGB? Notice this is a gender sequence that consists of 4 boys and 3 girls.
If I'm looking at gender sequences here, this example tells me to rearrange 2 types of letters, B's and G's. In fact, using the permutation rule, I'm going to get my answer. I have 2 types of letters, B's and G's, in which case there's 4 B's, 3 G's, for a total of 7 letters. Now notice that this setting really is saying how many different gender sequences are possible when I want to have 7 children, of which 4 will be boys. That implies 3 will be girls. So I'm looking at the total number of gender sequences that are possible simply by rearranging the B's and G's here, in which there's 4 B's and 3 G's, 4 boys and 3 girls. The permutation rule says the answer is going to be 7 factorial divided by 4 factorial times 3 factorial. 7 factorial divided by 4 factorial times 3 factorial. Some of you will recognize that this is a combination. 7C4. So, what I can do to deduce the answer is work by hand by writing down the definition of 7 factorial over 4 factorial times 3 factorial. Once again, use the cancellation property. 4 cancels. 3 times 2 is 6. Now what's left is 7 5 and the 1. So in the numerator, we'll have 35 divided by 1, which is simply 35. If I want to use the TI calculator, 7, math, probability, combination, 4. I also get the number 35. So that there are 35 distinct gender sequences that are possible when you want to have 7 children, of which 4 are boys. And that implies that 3 are girls.
What does this have to do with probability? Remember, the definition of the probability of an event is the number of outcomes associated with the event divided by the total number of outcomes in the sample space. Counting is simply determining numbers of outcomes. For example, gender sequences. A couple plans on having 7 children. What's the probability that the couple will have 4 boys? Notice that having 7 children, 4 of which are boys, implies that 3 are girls.
Now the probability of having 4 boys and 3 girls when you have 7 children. Remember, you have to determine the number of ways, or the number of gender sequences for 4 B's and 3 G's, divided by the total number of gender sequences. The denominator is N of S, the total number of gender sequences. We know that this value is 2 to the 7th power. And in the previous example, we know that the numerator turned out to be 35. Okay? So if we really wanted to remind ourselves what this was, the answer was 7C4, which was 35, divided by 2 to the 7th power. In our calculator, we can answer this question by 7. Look for probability for the combination key. C4 divided by 2 raised to the 7th power, the total number of gender sequences. We'll get 0.2734375. If we approximate this probability to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.273. The digit to the right is a 4, which means we leave the 3 alone. Approximately 0.273.
The 665 lottery. What's the probability of winning a 665 lottery?
The probability of winning a 665 lottery is found by simply determining the number of winning sequences divided by the total number of possible sequences of 6 numbers. Again, it's the number of winning sequences divided by the total number of possible sequences. We've sort of answered this question already. We know the denominator is 65C6 from a previous example. But we have to answer the question of how many winning sequences are possible. And this is sort of a trick question some people may find very easy and some people may find very difficult. But if we think about it, we can deduce the answer. Considering the denominator is the total number of possible sequences of 6 lottery numbers. Remember, in order to win a lottery, you need the winning sequence. The winning sequence means there is only one sequence corresponds to winning. So that the final answer is 1 over 65 C6. The 1 corresponds to the single winning sequence for the lottery. 65 C6 is the total number of possible sequences of 6 numbers. Numerically, we can determine this 1 over 65C6 by using our calculator. 1 divided by 65 math C6. Hit enter. And we get an answer that's in scientific notation. 1.21067019 e to that minus 8. Now what this is not a probability value that's greater than 1. This is scientific notation. In other words, this e to the minus 8 is really times 10 to the minus 8 power. That means I move this decimal 8 spaces to the left. The decimal you see here gets moved 8 spaces to the left. So, if I just use the first 3 numbers, the answer is approximately 1.21 times 10 to the minus 8 power, which is approximately 7 zeros, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 1. This is the probability or the likelihood of winning a 65-6 or 665 lottery. Notice that that number is approximately 0. It is very close to 0. And any probability that's close to 0 means it's close to being impossible, because the probability of 0, the probability of an event equals 0, means the event is impossible. So although it's still possible you can win a 65-6 or 665 lottery, it is not likely. The probability is close to 0.
Delivery routes. What's the probability of selecting the shortest route? Selecting the shortest route. Remember, a route is a stop at 7 different locations, and we cannot repeat a visit to a location. The probability that we select the shortest route is determined by simply knowing the number of shortest routes divided by the total number of possible routes. Now we already know that there's 7 factorial possible routes. However,
We have to determine what we mean by the shortest route, since we have to determine the numerator. How many routes are the shortest? And if you think of going to a location, stopping, going to another location, the second location, stopping, and finishing every location, that route will take a certain amount of time. And in fact, depending on where you go first, second, third, and so on, every single route, every single one of the 7 factorial routes will have its own unique time value, in which there will be only one route which will be the smallest or the shortest. So that the answer is 1 over 7 factorial. However, we want to determine this value numerically. 1 divided by 7, math, probability, factorial. Enter. This answer is in scientific notation, meaning I have to move this decimal, since this is a negative 4, 4 spaces to the left. So if I move that decimal 4 spaces to the left, there'll be 3 zeros in front of that number. Now, if I approximate this to the nearest 10th hundredth, this decimal I see here, 1.98, the answer is going to approximately be 0 with 1, 2, 3 zeros, 1, 9, 8. This is our approximate probability.
The prom committee. The student population in a small town includes 25 freshmen, 20 sophomores, 30 juniors, and 12 seniors. How many committees of 8 can be formed if the committee is to consist of A, any mixture, B, 2 seniors, C, 2 seniors and 2 juniors, D, 3 seniors, 2 juniors, 2 sophomores, and a freshman?
If we look at the prom committee distribution, in which there are 12 seniors, 30 juniors, sophomores, and 25 freshmen, we are trying to deduce the total number of distinct committees, different committees that are possible if we need 8 people to serve on this committee. Now, any mixture is the key phrase here, because what that means is if I add up the number of distinct people here, we find that there's 87 people. We don't care about their status as being a senior, junior, sophomore, or freshman. We only think of them as people for the any mixture problem. Any mixture means just think of them as without any status. So that your answer is going to be simply, out of the pool of 87 people, we need to choose 8 people. And these are combinations because we do not care about the order. It doesn't matter if we pick a senior before a junior, before a sophomore or a freshman. Order is not important. So therefore, this is a combination. Numerically, for any mixture, if I want to determine 87C8, my TI calculator will be very helpful. In which I get again an answer in scientific notation. However, this time, the answer is multiplied by 10 to the 10th power. You're moving this decimal 10 spaces to the right. So, what this means is this. I can approximate this answer by simply writing out all these values, maybe 5.84. And again, this is approximate, times 10 to the 10, which means move this decimal 10 spaces to the right. You get 5.84, followed by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 zeros. This answer is approximately, again, 58,400,000,000. If I take the same committee, although this time the committee is not any mixture, this time we want to specifically select two seniors, and that's the key here. Two seniors from a committee of eight. Now the key here is to use combinations in combination with, ironically, the fundamental principle of counting, the multiplication rule. And here's how you do this. If the requirement is we must have two seniors, well then, our first task is going to be to determine the number of ways to obtain two seniors from a pool of 12, in which we do not care about the order. We know that to be 12C2 because there's a pool of 12 seniors in which we only need two. The remaining six committee spots is any mixture. Now let's be careful. Any mixture except the seniors. In other words, these have to be non-seniors. So let's think. We don't care about the order, so they're combinations, and we know that. But out of the 87 people, 12 of which are seniors, that leaves 75 non-seniors, in which we need to choose 6. 75 non-seniors in which we need 6. So, if we take the 12C2 and multiply it with 75C6, we will get our answer. Again, a very large number. That is 1.32897303 times 10 to the 10th power. That means simply move this decimal 10 spaces to the right. So if I approximate this to the nearest hundredths and multiply it by 10 to the 10, this is going to be approximately 1.33 times 10 to the 10. Which means move this decimal 10 spaces to the right. 1.33, followed by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 zeros. $13,300,000,000. If our requirement now is no longer two seniors, but two seniors and two juniors, the setup is similar in that now, still using the multiplication principle or the fundamental principle of counting, we're going to now have to determine the number of ways to pick two juniors from a pool of 30 when we don't care about the order. And that'll be 30C2 for the number of juniors. Our first task is to select the number of seniors, 12C2. The second task is to determine the number of juniors, 30C2. And finally, the third task is again somewhat of any mixture except the seniors and the juniors. We don't want to use these two groups of people because we already established that there has to be two seniors and two juniors. Using them in the pool or keeping them in the pool has a possibility of adding more juniors and or seniors. So, from the remaining people, in which there are 45, and we need four, 45C4 is how we deduce the remaining number of committee members. Again, this is the multiplication rule, the counting principle. Determine the number of ways to select your seniors, the number of ways to select the juniors, and the number of ways to select this sort of modified any mixture when we exclude the number of seniors and juniors. Our calculator will help us deduce the answer. This is the final answer. The second task is determine the juniors. Since we have 30 juniors and we need two on the committee, that will be 30C2. This is the number of juniors when we need to select two of them. The third task is to determine the number of ways we can select our sophomores. 20C2 is for the third task, which is the number of sophomores. And finally, since we need one freshman on the committee, the last spot is for a freshman. We know that there are 25 freshmen to choose from. Task 1, determine the number of ways to obtain your three seniors, that's 12C3. Task 2, the number of ways to determine the two juniors, 30C2. Task 3, the number of ways to determine the two sophomores 20C2. And finally, task 4 is the number of freshmen to choose from, and there are 25 of them. If we multiply these numbers together, we will determine the number of possible committees in which we might have, or we're supposed to have, 3 seniors, 2 juniors, 2 sophomore, and a single freshman. Using the TI calculator. C2 times 30C2 times 20C2 times 25. This is our answer. Looks like 136,372,500 different ways that we can select a committee of 8 that must be of 3 seniors, 2 juniors, 2 sophomore, and 1 freshman.
The prom committee. The student population in a small town includes 25 freshmen, 20 sophomore, 30 juniors, and 12 seniors. If a committee of 8 is to be formed, what's the probability the committee consists of A, 2 seniors, B, 2 seniors and 2 juniors, C, 3 seniors, 2 juniors, 2 sophomore, and a freshman?
Consider our committee problem. We're going to deduce the probability of selecting a committee that has exactly 2 seniors. Remember, it's a committee of 8, so exactly 2 seniors means you have 2 seniors and you have 6 non-seniors. That's our numerator, and N of S is the denominator. Now, we've already determined actually both of these values, the numerator and the denominator. The denominator, N of S, is simply the total number of possible committees of 8. That is our any mixture problem. That was the 87C8. This is N of S. We've also computed the number of committees that are possible that consist of exactly 2 seniors. In a previous example, we found that it was 12C2 times 75C6. The pool of 12 seniors, in which we need 2, times the pool of 75 non-seniors, in which we need 6. This is the multiplication rule. Our numerator and our denominator. Let's see the answer numerically. In our calculator, place a parenthesis around the numerator because it is consistent of two operations, the multiplication of two combinations. C6 divided by 87C8. And the answer is 0.22743318 05. If we approximate this value to the nearest thousandths, The answer is 0.227. If we want to determine the probability of selecting exactly two seniors and two juniors, we use the definition of probability. It's the number of ways to select two seniors and two juniors divided by N of S, which we already know is 87C8. Now, we've also determined already the numerator as well in a previous example. We have found that it was 12C2 times 30C2 by the multiplication rule. That is, the pool of 12 seniors, we need to select 2. And from the pool of 30 juniors, we need to select another 2. Don't forget that the remaining four seats is from a pool of 45 non-seniors and non-juniors. This was all determined from a previous problem. So that if I look at these values in my TI calculator, I can deduce the numerical answer. Again, for the numerator, place this in a parenthesis because there's three numbers we have to multiply together. 12C2. 30C2 times 45C4. Divided by the any mixture, 87C8. This is our answer. If we approximate this answer to the nearest thousandths, it is 0.073. This is the probability that a committee of 8 will be composed of 2 seniors and 2 juniors, and obviously what's implied is 4 non-seniors and juniors. The last probability example, we would like our committee to be composed of 3 seniors, 2 juniors, 2 sophomores, and a freshman. We've already seen how to compute the numerator value and the denominator value. The denominator is the any mixture problem, 87C8. The numerator we're already seeing as 12C3 times 30C2 times 20C2 times 25. If we Enter all of this in our calculator again for the numerator. Use the parentheses because this time we have four things to multiply together. 12C3 is 1. 30C2 times 20C2 times the number 25 divided by 87C8. If we approximate this value to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.008.
A dozen eggs. A carton of a dozen eggs, that's 12 eggs, unfortunately has 3 that are rotten. If 3 eggs are selected to make an omelet, what's the probability that A. None of the rotten eggs will be selected. B. One of the rotten eggs will be selected. C. Two of the rotten eggs will be selected. And D. All of the rotten eggs will be selected.
If we look at the omelet problem, we note that there are 12 eggs, which 3 are rotten. That implies that 9 are okay. Okay, so we're going to keep track of the fact that we have 3 rotten eggs, but 9 are okay. Now, this omelet is going to be composed of 3 eggs. Okay, so let's note that if we're going to answer a probability question, that what's the probability that none of the eggs that are rotten are selected, means that the 3 eggs that are selected for the omelet are all okay. So, let's consider this probability question. All are okay. Well, for the denominator, we need to answer the any mixture question, which means simply 12C3. Of the 12 eggs total, we need 3 to make an omelet. However, for the numerator, we need to know the number of ways we can select 3 eggs in which all of them are okay. Well, since 9 eggs are in the pool of okay eggs, and we need 3, that will be 9C3. In other words, if we determine 9C3 over 12C3, this will answer the question of what's the probability when you make an omelet consisting of 3 eggs that all 3 are okay. If we approximate this answer to the nearest thousandths, the 8 to the right of the digit in the thousandths position, the 1, means add 1 to the 1, and the answer is approximately 0.382. This is the probability that all of the eggs are okay. Now, if we approach the same problem in a way that this time we wanted to deduce the probability that when we make this omelet with three eggs, what's the probability that one egg is rotten? One egg is rotten. One rotten egg means the remaining two eggs are okay. We use the multiplication rule to determine the numerator because the denominator, again, is the any mixture question, which is 12C3. However, the numerator is going to be, well, we need to know how many eggs were rotten. Remember, three were rotten. Nine are okay. So this will be 3 times 9C2, because 3 rotten eggs for the first task, 9C2 eggs for the second task. Using our calculator, put a parenthesis around the numerator because we have a multiplication problem to perform. Final answer is 0.4909009 and so on. If we approximate this value to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.491. Let's look at the problem, but only this time, two eggs are rotten. Okay? So, if the omelet is composed of three eggs, in which two are rotten, which means one is okay. Remember, there's three rotten eggs and nine eggs that are okay in our dozen eggs. Probability, the denominator again is the any mixture, which is 12C3. But the numerator is going to be, well, let's see. The first task is to determine the number of ways to select two rotten eggs from a batch of 3C2. The second task is to determine the number of ways to determine an okay egg, in which case there were 9. So that 3C2 times 9 is our numerator in our probability. Use a parenthesis again because we have a product to perform in the numerator, 3C2. Divided by, let's not forget to multiply times 9, divided by 12C3. The answer is approximately 0.12272727 and so on. If we approximate this value to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.123. If we're going to make an omelet that consists of 3 eggs, what's the probability of selecting every rotten egg for the omelet. That means all three eggs were rotten. Again, the denominator is any mixture, which is 12C3. The numerator is, well, let's see. There were 9 okay eggs in which 3 were rotten. We have a pool of 3 in which we need to select 3 eggs that are rotten. That's 3C3. This is also known as the number 1. So, using our calculator, 1 divided by 12C3 is 0.00454545 and so on. If we approximate this to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.005.
Consider the following example where 5 eggs are selected to make an omelet. What's the probability that A, none of the rotten eggs will be selected, B, 1 of the rotten eggs will be selected, C, 2 of the rotten eggs will be selected, and D, all of the rotten eggs will be selected? Remember, you are using 5 eggs. We're going to look at the omelet problem again. Our dozen eggs consist of 9 that are okay, but 3 are rotten. And in this setting, we need 5 eggs to make an omelet. This is a 5 egg omelet. The first question asks, what's the likelihood that all of the 5 eggs that you use are okay? Now, again, the denominator corresponds to the any mixture problem, meaning that 12 dozen eggs from that pool, we need to select 5 eggs to make the omelet. The denominator is any mixture. However, the numerator has a pool of 9 okay eggs in which we need to use 5 to make that omelet. So the probability of selecting all 5 of the okay eggs when you make a 5 egg omelet will be 9C5 over 12C5. Numerically, the answer is 0.1590909 and so on. If we approximate this answer to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.159. If we try to make a 5 egg omelet in which we have to determine the probability that one of those eggs is rotten, we answer it by looking at this problem again using the fundamental principle of counting. One rotten egg means the remaining 4 are okay, so that I have 2 tasks to perform. Task 1 is to determine the number of ways I can select a rotten egg. 3C1 times the number of ways I can select 4 okay eggs. 9C4. And that is because 9 eggs are okay, 3 eggs are rotten. So that the probability is answered by 3C1 times 9C4 over, again, the any mixture question, which is, consider the pool to be of any eggs. Whether they're okay or rotten doesn't matter. Of the dozen eggs, you need 5 to make the omelet. Using the TI calculator, 3C1 times 9C4 divided by 12 C5. The answer is 0.47727727 and so on. If we approximate this to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.477. If we make our omelet again, and now we want to determine the probability that 2 are rotten, remember, our pool of 9 okay eggs, 3 rotten eggs, and it takes 5 eggs to make an omelet. Again, we're going to use the counting principle to determine the numerator in our probability. The denominator, again, is the any mixture question. Of the dozen eggs, we need 5 to make the omelet. 12C5 is N of S. If we look at the fundamental principle of counting, our first task is to determine the number of ways to select 2 rotten eggs from a pool of 3 eggs. That is 3C2. The second task is to determine the number of ways to select 3 okay eggs from a pool of 9, 9C3. So the numerator is 3C2 times 9C3 by the counting principle. The denominator is any mixture. This is how we answer the probability question. Again, use a parenthesis around the numerator because there's a product of combinations to perform. 3C2 times 9C3 divided by 12C5. The answer is 0.3181818 and so on. If we approximate this answer to the nearest thousandths, it is 0.318. If we look at the last question, the probability that 3 eggs that are used will be rotten, or all of the rotten eggs are used, since 9 are okay, 3 are rotten. We're going to make an omelet of 5 in which we're going to use all 3 rotten eggs. We're going to determine the likelihood of that happening. Again, the omelet is a 5 egg omelet. We need 5 eggs to make this omelet. 3 eggs are rotten. The remaining two are okay. So again, to determine the probability, the denominator is the any mixture question. Of the 12 eggs, you need 5 to make the omelet. Now, using the fundamental principle of counting again to determine the numerator, we need to find how many ways can we perform the first task. In other words, out of the pool of 3 rotten eggs, we need to select 3 eggs for the first task. That's 3C3. Out of the pool of 9 okay eggs, we need to select 2 of them. So that the numerator is 3C3 times 9C2 for our probability question, while the denominator is simply 12C5. Using our calculator to deduce the answer, we'll use a parenthesis for the numerator, because we have a product to perform, 3C3, which we know is 1, times 9C2, we will close the parentheses and divide by 12C5. The answer is approximately 0.0454545, and so on. If we approximate this to the nearest thousandths, the answer is 0.04.